Welcome in lecture 11, devoted to waves and optics. So here we continue on optical interference, and we will introduce Young's double slit experiment and talk about diffraction. So first we are going to have a first look at diffraction, then we will describe Young's double slit experiment. And then we will extend this to several slits and talk about gratings. And in the end, we will see the effect of diffraction on interference. So as usual, we use the three books shown here. So the three ebooks from OpenStax, Physics from John Colley, and Fundamentals of Physics from Halliday and Co-workers. So let's start with that simple observation. Here we have two slits, S1, S2, and we illuminate that with some parallel beam. So the rays are all parallel, like this, and we observe the result on the screen. Alright, so if we had particles, if light was behaving like a particle, we would observe the image of the two slits. Okay? But this is what we actually observe with light, in particular visible light. So, question, why do we get this? If we had light traveling along straight lines, like this is what we have actually said when we studied light so far, so the rays would just be blocked here and just go through the two slits, and we would get an image of the two slits like this. And we would not get this. So, this is a result of the wave nature of light. Okay, we cannot say now that light is just going in straight line like this. Okay, and this is because now these slits, the dimensions are close to that of the wavelengths of light, and in such a case we have diffraction phenomena showing up. So as we will see very soon. So what I have just shown you was just a drawing, but this is actually the a real experiment. So you have let's say a red laser incident on a double slit. And this is what you observe on the screen. So you observe a lot of dots, spots, bright dots, separated by dark dots. So this is what we call an interference pattern. And the alternating maxima and minima are called interference fringes. So this is a bright fringe, and this is a dark fringe. So to explain this, we need to look at diffraction. So let's look at first just one shadow mask. So here you have a wave incident, and we have a kind of, it could be a metal plate or something, so a mask. And so the light is stopped by this plate, and here it can continue. So what we observe is that the wave fronts, so here it's a plane wave, so it continues as a plane wave here, but on the side here you have kind of spherical wave fronts. So if you have a slit relatively wide, so wider than the wavelengths, you would get something like that. So you still have some kind of plane wave propagating through the slit here. But on the side, you have some effect. So this is the effect of diffraction. Here, if you have a narrow slit, so here it's just smaller than the one wavelength, you see that you only see this spherical wave. So now, you transform a kind of plane waves into a kind of point source. Okay, and all this. So here the diffraction is very important. Here it is not so not such a big effect because you still have your wave transmitted as a plane wave. So here, for example, if you had a screen somewhere here, you would have some kind of bright area here, and you would still get some light on the side here. Okay. If light was just a particle, we would get just, so imagine particles incident. They would be stopped here, and they would continue here, and you would get only some particles in this place, let's say, and nothing around up and down. Okay, so this is really this kind of spherical, these spherical wave fronts here are really due to diffraction. And in this case, when the slit is comparable to the wavelength, we get a very large effect of diffraction. And in fact, this slit now behaves like a point source because these are spherical wave fronts. So we can see such a thing actually in everyday life, like these things that were built in order to limit probably the flow of water on the beach. So you see that so the wave here is roughly well, it's not a plane wave, but you see that the wave fronts are roughly linear, and here the waves are blocked by these, but can still go through here, and you see that this kind of spherical wave fronts here. So this behaves almost like spherical waves, point sources. Anyway, it all depends on the size with respect to the wavelengths, of course. This is how we can explain this using Huygens' principle. Remember Huygens? So here we have indeed a plane wave. So bright spots may be, for example, the maxima, and the dark, the black would be a trough. Okay, so if you have your slit here, and if you imagine that you have point sources here, and when they receive a wave, they emit in the right part of the space here. You have some kind of actually some kind of interference between all the sources, but okay, we'll come back to that later. Here, in this case, you see that the dimension of the slit is the same as the wavelength, and in that case, you see that what we get using Huygens' principle is almost like a point source. Of course, here we don't get much light. But in all this space, it's sphere. We have spherical waves, okay, spherical wave fronts. So we can form like point sources from a plane wave using just a small slit. So this is just from the book of Fundamentals of Physics from Halliday and the co-workers. So the same story. Here you see that A is 6 lambda, so it's big, so you get roughly, so it's a bit curved, but it's roughly still like a plane wave. Here you have 3 lambda, so it becomes more curved, and here you have just 1.5 lambda for the slit, and here you see it's very much curved due to diffraction. So here, this is a reminder of the Huygens principle. When you have a wave front and you want to find out where is the next wave front, you just assume that each point on that wave front can be considered as as point sources of spherical secondary wavelets, and then so you can draw all these spherical wave fronts, and after one period, you look at where the tangential position of all of these. And this defines your new wave front. Let's have a look to an animation now, so taken from the Colorado University. So here we have a, let's say, one slit, so we can actually remove it, no barrier, okay? We can, so we have a light generator, okay, so it can be a light, but it can be water also. Let's remove the barrier. Okay, can be water. We can decide the frequency. So it changes the frequency, changes the wavelength. So the distance between wavefronts decreases when you increase the frequency. Okay. amplitude. Yeah, it is just so the brighter the color, the brighter the higher the amplitude. We can choose in this case water. So this represents the wavefronts. Okay, we can use select sound also. So in this case, this bright area would correspond to a maximum amplitude displacement of the molecules, for example. Or we can use light. So a light, so this is a wave of light. So this is, let's say the green here is maximum amplitude and the dark is the minimum amplitude of the wave, of the electric field, for example. So we can choose the frequency or the wavelength. So higher frequency means lower wavelengths. Okay, so you see, yeah, the distance increases as you lower the frequency. Okay. Screen. If we put a screen here, we have a uniform intensity. All right, so now let's use one slit. So, as we have seen in the previous slides, we have, because this slit is small, almost the distance between wavefronts, so almost the wavelengths, we get like a point source, so spherical wavefronts. So we can change the slit width actually. So if we go very far here, a larger slit, we see some, still this area has like some kind of plane wave maintained here. If we put a screen, we will get a very bright area here, like the image of that slit, in fact. But we still get something over there. So it's not a very clean definition of that slit. And then when we get a very small slit, then you get some kind of, you just get the intersection of these wavefronts with that, so high intensity here and the lower here because you are at a higher distance from the source. All right, so now let's do the Young's double slit experiment. So we are going to put two slits and the slits are small like this, so we get so they behave like point sources. Okay. So two slits, so it is as if we had, in fact, on this side of the space, we see just two point sources. And they are, so remember the condition for interference, they must be same amplitude, they must have same frequency, and also they must be coherent. And here, because we start with the same wave, of course they have the same frequency, they are coherent. And because the slits have the same width here, they are also of the same amplitude. So this way is a very easy and reliable way to get interference from two identical sources. Alright, so what do we get here? So if we put a screen somewhere here, you see that we get a bright fringe here and another there, another here, and some completely dark fringe in between. So this is like the picture I showed you these red dots that we can observe. So we find that this is completely different from the shadow of that slit, because this slit should be, if light was like particles or straight line, so the rays were, the light was just propagating in straight line, we would get an image of this slit here, but here is roughly dark in fact, and another here, but it's dark, so it doesn't match at all the particle model of for the light. Okay, and one very big surprise is that here, exactly in the middle, so here normally you have no light propagating through this, but we have a very bright spot just in the middle. Okay, so this is an interference pattern, and here actually we can see that pattern in space. You can see that, so let's pause it. These are the wavefronts, okay? And so it's a bit messy close to the sources, but far away you see that there is a clear pattern. There is, in this direction, we have some clear wave here going on in this direction, and this gives rise to this bright fringe. And also here we get a clear bright, dark in this direction. So this is a wave propagating in this direction. So we have a bright spot also here. And here where there are some dark fringes, we see that along this direction, there is indeed very low intensity along this direction. Okay. And also here. And also here, so okay. So we are going to, so this is the so-called Young's double slit experiment, and it was definitely showing that light is a wave phenomenon. Okay. So of course by now you probably know about the photon, that light also behave like a particle in some situation. All right, but wave is definitely light is definitely a wave, as demonstrated by this experiment. All right, so this is what we have seen in the animation. You have here parallel rays, therefore a plane wave. These are in blue, you have the wave fronts. And you have two slits, S1 and S2 here, so they emit spherical waves, and you look at what happens on a screen. So now, let's explain what we have observed. Here you have interference at this inside this red circle. You have constructive interference. Why? Because you have this, let's say this is a maximum, and from S1, and this is a maximum from S2. Okay, so here you have the sum of the two maxima. So you have constructive interference at this location. And you have also at all these locations where they intersect. Right? All these. So you have constructive interference here. And you will also have constructive interference here from this wavefront with this one. It continues there and will intersect here. And so on. This one will intersect this one here. So you will have constructive interference in this direction. Okay. And therefore, here you will have a bright fringe, high intensity. And now let's look at destructive interference. So for destructive interference, you need to add a maximum and a minimum. Okay, so they cancel each other. So, for example, this green circle here, you have a maximum due to this wavefront and a minimum due to here. So this is between maxima, you have a minimum. Okay. So here, between these two, this wavefront and this front, you have a minimum here. So a minimum plus this one, a maximum, you have destructive interference. Okay. And this happens also all the way in this direction. Okay. So here, for example, you have a max from this wavefront and a minimum in between two wavefront from this one. So along this direction, you will have a destructive interference and therefore a dark fringe here. So here we have represented several of these bright and dark fringes. So you see that the bright fringes correspond to intersection of wavefronts, and the dark fringes correspond here the yellow dots to one wavefront with the intersection between two wavefronts. Okay. Here also, what we see is that we can observe this experiment. We can do this experiment with several types of setup. All you need is a double slit, so in order to have two point sources. But the making of these two point sources, you have the choice. There are several ways to construct these two point sources. So just before, we have seen that we have used just a plane wave incident on this plate with the two slits, and this was enough. But you can also use this setup. So in this case, you have a plane wave incident on a one slit, which then is considered as a light point source, a point source which emits. So this light, and then this light is incident on this plate with two slits, and then you just have again two point sources from the two slits. Okay, so it depends on the setup. So here is also represented the same kind of setup, an incident plane wave transformed into a point source. Incident on two slits and therefore generating two new point sources. So you may read all this to let you understand better this experiment. So how can we explain now where the bright fringes and dark fringes are located? So where do we have constructive interference and where do we have destructive interference? Okay, so what we have seen is that at the center there was a bright fringe, therefore constructive interference. And we can understand this if we have two slits here by the fact, remember, we are looking at interference at some given points in space. Okay, so we have two waves superimposed at that point. So one wave comes from S1 and the other one comes from S2. Okay, the way they interfere will depend on the optical path difference between the two waves. So in this particular case, we see that the distance S1 to that point is the same as the distance from S2 to that point. Therefore, there is no optical path difference between the two waves, and therefore they interfere constructively. Because originally, there is no phase shift between the two waves. So then, the next bright fringe. So the next point in this screen where you will have constructive interference correspond to a point when the two waves coming from S1 and S2 will have an optical path difference of one wavelength. Remember, the condition is The difference in optical path is called m lambda, m being an integer. So the first maximum here will be obtained when the difference in optical path is one wavelength. Okay, and because this is in air, you don't have to look at. So the optical path, remember, is the delta equal n delta x. So because n here is 1, let's say in air, it could be another index, but okay, in air it is 1, so you just have to look at the difference in distance in this particular case. So this should be lambda, okay, because this distance is equal to that one. So the extra distance traveled by the second wave here has to be one wavelength. Okay, and for a destructive interference, for the first black dark fringe here, you need to have fully destructive interference here. So you know that to get fully destructive interference, you need an optical path difference of half a lambda. And therefore, this distance has to be half a wavelength. So let's go into more details. So we have to find out this extra distance traveled by one of the waves. So here we take an approximation. We say that the screen is very far away from these slits. So in this case, when you are very far away, these two rays can be viewed as being parallel. So like this. Okay. And the angle theta that is written here is also the angle of the two rays with the horizontal. Okay, so this is the approximation done for this. So in this case, now it's quite simple to get that extra distance traveled by ray 1 compared to ray 2 in this case. Okay, so this is d, the distance between the two slits, and this turns out to be just d sine theta, that extra distance. So this is the path length difference. So now we can use that to find out the locations of the fringes. Okay. So for a bright fringe, delta L will be either zero or an integer number of wavelengths. Therefore, this should be, so d sine theta must be an integer times lambda. And for a dark fringe, delta L must be another multiple of half a wavelength. Therefore, we have this condition. So this is using the optical path difference. We can also use the phases. So you just multiply by 2 pi over lambda. So this is 2 pi over lambda multiplied by your optical path. So in such case, you would get phase shift between the two rays of 2 pi over lambda multiplied by d sine theta. Okay, so for constructive interference, of course, you would have phi equal m2 lambda, and therefore this, which is equivalent to the optical path difference of m lambda. And for destructive, you would have this condition. Okay, and from this you come back to the condition we had here for the optical path. Okay, so these are very important, they will be used all the time for in the Young's experiment. Let's now look at the intensity of interference. So we have to be careful here, we are dealing with vectors. Electric field is a vector. So when you add two Electromagnetic waves at one point, you add the vectors in fact. Huh? So you have to be careful. In our case, in this first year physics course, we won't have to care much about that. It will always be a sum of scalar, because they will always be like parallel. But in general, be careful, the electric field is a vector. So when you have two waves interfering, you have to take into account the sum of the two vectors. Okay. So the intensity will be given by, remember, it is the time average of the pointing vector, of the flux of the energy. So the pointing flux S is proportional to the square of the total field. So it will be the square of E1 plus E2. So you develop, you will have E1 squared, E2 squared plus this term. This is the term responsible for the interference, in fact. So we take the time average of that to get the intensity of the light at a point P. So we get okay, the average of this one, the average of this one, and the average of that product. So the cross term is, as I said, really what contains the interference, so the correlation between the two light waves. And let's look now for incoherent light sources. So remember, incoherent means that the phase shift between the two waves is not a constant. It can fluctuate. Since there is no definite phase relation between E1 and E2, the cross term vanishes. So this is the time average. Okay, so E1 and E2 can take any direction. Okay, so in average, their scalar product will vanish. Okay. And the intensity due to the incoherent source is simply the sum of two individual intensities. So it will just be this sum, these two. So I1 plus I2. Okay. However, if the two sources are coherent, this term will not be always zero. So it will, in fact, for constructive interference, we have E1 equal E2, and the resulting intensity will then be four times I1. Okay, this is what we have observed already when we add two waves. Okay, and we will see that again shortly. So this is four times greater than intensity due to a single source. We have seen that already. On the other hand, when destructive interference takes place, then we have the two cancel each other. So we have E1 equal minus E2. Okay. And in this case, the product here will be equal to minus I1. And the total will be, so you will have I1 plus I1 because I2 is equal to I1. And minus 2, so this term will bring you a minus 2 I1, and it is 0. Okay. So this is when you get so fully constructive interference here and fully destructive interference here. And of course, the power is conserved. Okay, you have half the space, let's say, you will have 4 I, not in half the space, but in okay, because it's fluctuate like this. So in some part of the space, so the intensity will fluctuate like that. We will see that soon. And you have seen, remember, it's a cos squared. Okay. And so maximum is 4i here, and here is 0. So if you integrate over the space, you will find like 2i1, like the case of incoherent. For incoherent, you would get just 2i1. Okay. So, don't worry, we are going to see that again very soon. So let's do the calculation when we have E1 and E2 on the same line. So we can just add them, add the scalar value of the two. So we have E1 equal that, E2 is the same but with a phase shift. So we've done that already, summing these two. And then we will have to look at the intensity, which is proportional to the amplitude squared. So let's do E equal E1 plus E2. So we've done that many times in this course. We get this. Okay, this is a traveling wave, phase shifted by phi over 2 with respect to the first wave. And this is the amplitude. Okay, and that amplitude has to be is put in this. Okay, the intensity will be proportional to the square of this. So we do the calculation, we find in the end this. So here you see that 4 showing up. And half of C epsilon 0 EM is in fact the intensity of that wave, of one of the waves. Okay, so in the end, you can write that your intensity is 4 times, so the intensity of one wave, I0, multiplied by cosine squared. And that depends on phi, of course, that phi. And in that phi, this is a phase shift between the two waves. So in the double slit experiment, it will be related to the optical path difference. Okay. So your intensity will depend on the optical path difference between the two waves. So and it will be maximum, of course, as usual for n for phi equal n to pi, and minimum for this condition. So here we have represented that the formula of this intensity, and so it is in fact so the intensity is plotted here as a function of position on that screen. Okay, so it's a cosine squared function. So let's look at this in more detail. So this phi here depends on theta. Theta again is this angle. And in fact, this phi is this number, this formula. So it's not exactly the same, but this phi is that one. Okay. So this is from what we have. This is in fact the phase shift between the two rays. Okay. We have established that just before. So it's 2 pi over lambda multiplied by the optical path difference, which is d sine theta. So maxima will be for phi equal m 2 pi, that is for sine theta equal m lambda divided by d. Okay, so this is what you get on the screen. So it's a cos squared function. So this is a function as a function of phi. Okay, so you have indeed a max at 0, at 2 pi, etc. Let's look at this now. So I0, so if you had only one source, you would get close to the center, you would have a constant intensity close to that that area, because otherwise it is a spherical symmetry, so it should go down away here, but close to that center it should be flat. And so 2I0 for two incoherent sources. So remember, we have seen that just two or three slides ago. If the two lights are incoherent, then the correlation terms, the I1 cross dot product with E2, the electric field 1 cross product no, not cross product. Scalar product with E2 vanishes in average over time. Okay, so you just have two I0 flat. And this is when you have coherent, two coherent sources, and you have a maximum of four I0 in some part of the space, and some minima of zero in some other part of the space. Okay, so this M here shows minimum, the minima, so this is order zero. We call that the order of the maximum, so zero, M equal one, you would get that, M, the first maximum here, let's say, and the second maximum, etc. And this M corresponds to that one, okay? So M is related to theta. Okay. And here you have M for minima, okay? And this is the number of wavelengths in the optical path difference. So of course you have, when the optical path difference is one or an integer, you have constructive interference. So you have that for zero, no path difference between the two waves, so here. And one wavelength difference here, two wavelengths difference, etc. Okay, and you have your minima when you have an odd integer, not an odd integer, yeah, an odd integer of half a wavelength. So 0.5, 1.5, 2.5 of lambda. Okay. Okay, so we've discussed that already. Let us now find the positions of the fringes on the screen. So the distance between the maxima, let's say. Alright, so the first maximum here is for M equals zero, okay, for the condition of interference, of constructive interference, and the second maximum here, let's say this one, will be at M equals one. Okay, so the delta theta here, this angle between M equals zero and M equals one, is given by that optical path equal lambda. The optical path difference is lambda. Now we use the approximation of long distance. So L is very high compared to D. Okay, so the screen is far away from the slit. So in that case, we have both D much lower than L, and Y, so Y is this distance, what we are looking for, much lower than L. So in such a case, so you see that here, if you take the tangent theta, so tangent of delta theta, will be Y divided by L. So this is this is what we want, this is given, and we just have to know tangent theta. But we have here sine theta, not tangent. However, we know that theta is very small when L is long, is high compared to D. And in such a case, you have the approximation that the tangent theta is roughly equal to sine theta, and in fact roughly equal to theta itself. Okay, so we can write this. So now we can, if we substitute so this sine theta here in this equation, we will get what we are looking for, y. Okay, so we do that. And we get y equal m l lambda divided by d. And of course, the distance between the bright and dark fringes on the screen is just obtained by taking two successive consecutive maxima. So let's take, for example, from m equals 0 to m equal 1, you just put m equal 1 here and you get the distance between the maxima here in space on the screen is equal to L lambda divided by D. And this is very interesting because you see that this is something you can measure on a screen. And you have here L. L you can measure it also. You know where you put your screen. And then you have lambda divided by D. So you see that you can measure one of the two. So if you know lambda, you know the wavelengths you are using, you can determine D by just measuring delta y. Okay. You can measure the distance between the two slits. So alternatively, if you know your slits, the distance of your slits, you can determine a wavelength or even a distance. If you know your wavelengths and your slits, you can determine the distance, a distance, okay. Distance L. Okay, so here we have plotted again this function, and so here you have the position as a function of y. Okay, so the first maximum it has is at lambda L divided by D. Okay, the next is at 2L lambda divided by D. So if you have let's say white light, not just one wavelength, but white light, which include all the wavelengths of the visible light, so from red to violet. So at the center here, you will have white light, because the optical path difference is the same, is zero. And this is for all the wavelengths. So all the wavelengths will gather at that point, and therefore you still have white light. However, at that maximum here, that maximum delta y, the position here, will depend on the wavelength according to this equation. Therefore, the longer the wavelength, the farther away will be the maximum. Okay, so the higher the delta y. So red has a longer wavelength than blue. Okay, so the maximum for red will be here, let's say, and the maximum for blue will be a little bit at a lesser position. Okay, so at this position. So this is useful also because you can separate. You can have a kind of prism effect. You can separate colors using the double slit experiment. And this is actually used in devices. So this one, again, this one is just the first maximum. Okay? You would have also the same for m equal 2. Okay? A bit farther away, you would again get this, this decomposition. So actually this is used in what we call spectrometers. Okay, and instead of the just two slits, we use many slits, and we are going to see that very soon. And these are called gratings. So okay, I'll explain how it works on this simple device. This is a real device. Actually I have one of them in my laboratory. So light is collected here. So you have the light enters here. You have a mirror. It sends the light here on this, and the grating is there. So in fact, the two-slit experiment works by transmission, but also by reflection. Okay, so it's like the thin film interference. It works by transmission, but also by reflection. So here you have a reflection. So that one, what you see here from, so there is decomposition of from red to blue here. This is a first order reflection. If it is a reflection for the maximum at m equal 1. Okay, so we have that first reflection where light is decomposed into the different wavelengths, And then you have another mirror here which spreads that signal onto a what we call a CCD, so charged coupled device. So it's like a CCD that you have in your in a camera, in your phone also. So and each piece, there are many detectors here, and each one detects one piece of the signal. So you can reconstruct then with a computer the spectrum of the light emitted, because you will know how much blue, the intensity of the blue emitted, the intensity of the green, the intensity of the red, etc., and make a kind of spectrum. So I can maybe draw that somewhere, let's say here. So you can, for different wavelengths, you can, with this device, look at what the intensity for each wavelength from red to blue, let's say. Okay, and this is the intensity. Let's now look at multiple slit interference. So now we have three slits, 1, 2, 3. And let's look at the direction defined by angle theta. So we have three rays, 1, 2, 3. And the optical path difference is defined as usual by d sine theta for this one, so compared to this one, and 2d sine theta for ray 3 with respect to ray 1. So now for constructive interference, we need to have, so between ray 1 and ray 2, we need to have this. And for the second one, we also have, we need to have also 2d sine theta equal n lambda. So here indeed, if you multiply this by 2, you will have 2m, which is also an integer. So you will have a constructive interference between ray 1 and ray 2, and also between ray 1 and ray 3, and ray 2 and ray 3. So it's total constructive interference. The three arrays are in phase, will arrive in phase on the screen, and therefore you will have a maximum in the intensity. So all three arrays combine constructively, and the bright fringes are called principal maxima. So if there are some principal maxima, it means there are some non-principal maxima, and we are going to see that soon. Okay, so let's look at destructive interference now. So basically, we would say that the optical path difference between ray 1 and ray 2 should be half a wavelength. Okay, so as written here, but what about the third ray in this case? If you have this length equal half a lambda, this one will be two times that, and it will be lambda. Therefore, ray 1 and ray 3 will be in phase. They will interfere constructively. Of course, ray 1 and ray 2 will interfere destructively, but you still have ray 3 unaltered. Okay, so you will still have some intensity on your screen, and this is called a secondary maximum. So that intensity, of course, will be lower than that of principal maxima, because you do not, all the rays are not in phase. So this is very different from just two slits. Two slits, you just say this equals lambda over 2, and that's it. It works. But now it's more complicated than that. So on your screen, what you get is in fact this. You have a maximum at zero, of course, and then at lambda over d, you will have, so this is for sine theta, so this is for the first principal maximum, when all the rays are in phase, you get a maximum. and this is a principal maximum. So, and these are the pictures associated. So, let's see, you have two slits for the purple one, so this one. So, this is the typical result that we have seen. So, a maximum, a minimum, a maximum, etc. And this looks like a sine square. Now, if you have three slits, you have now a maximum here. For this value, so all the slits are in phase, and but in between principal maxima, you have, in this case, one secondary maximum. Okay, this one, and you can see that on the picture here, you have the large maxima here, and in between you have small, dimmer maxima. Okay, just one in between the main maxima. Okay, so let's look now when you have four slits. So four slits, it will just follow a pattern. You see, you will still have your principal maxima located at the same location. And in between the principal maxima, you will have now two secondary maxima. Okay. So when you add a slit compared to the two slits, when you add one slit, you introduce an intermediate maximum in between the principal maxima. Okay. So for that blue curve, you have the blue pattern here. So you see the principal maxima are clearly seen again. And in between, you can still see there, two small maxima. And so one thing that is worth noticing here is that you notice that the principal maxima increase, the intensity increases with the number of slits, and they become narrower, right? So this reflects energy conservation, because if you take the integral in space of all these curves, you should find roughly the same. You should find the same, because energy is distributed in space and energy is conserved. So if you have a higher intensity here, you should also have a narrower curve here. Here we see a pattern, interference pattern, when n equals 6, so 6 slits. So we have the main maximum, of course, at 0 here. So this is again a sine, so zebrite alpha instead of theta. So you have, and a is the distance between the slits. So you have your principal maximum here, another one here, and in between you see the intermediate maxima, the secondary maxima, and they are separated by lambda over a. Here. So you see there are 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four of them in between principal maxima. So when you have a lot of slits, many, many slits, like shown here on this this kind of plate, with some lines, so you have some holes, some lines are so grooves here are cut out at regular spacing d, so it means you have some lines and holes like this. So this is called a diffraction grating. Okay, this is very important. It is used in, as I said just before, in the spectrometers, for example. So what happens when you have many, many slits? So this is illustrated here. So you have a lot of slits here. Distance between the slits is d. You have, so you can look at some point, you have interference between all these rays. So what you find on your screen is, so we have seen that when you increase the number of slits, the intensity increases, becomes higher, and the width of each principal maximum becomes very narrow. So in fact, you will get extremely narrow peaks now, instead of, remember when you had only two slits, you had some kind of something like that, square, cosine squared. Sorry for, it is supposed to be sine squared, okay, something like that. So again, energy is conserved. So the peaks becomes much more intense, but also much more narrow. Okay, and this is very very useful because if it is the intensity is higher, it's easy to detect. And if it is very localized in space, it's also very easy to localize the maxima in space. So let's look in more details these gratings. Here you have many slits. Again, the path difference will be d sine theta in between each ray. And you have your maxima when d sine theta equals m lambda. For different m, which is the order of diffraction. Here they say the rays from the rulings, so there are different vocabulary that is used for these. So in this case, they can call that the rulings. So okay, so we have seen the condition for the principal maxima. So now let's look at the condition for the minima. So let's see now where are the minima. So we know that for theta equals 0, we have a maximum. So this is the zeroth order maximum. So let's find out what is the angle corresponding to the first minimum. Okay, so let's look at this to illustrate this point. So you have here your grating with many slits, so you have n slits. So this distance is nd. D is the distance between two slits. Okay, so in fact, if you want fully destructive interference in this direction, you need to have this configuration. You notice that if you take this one as the reference, then at the middle, at the center here of the grating, you need to have a half a wavelength difference. So that this one will be out of phase with this one and they will cancel each other. Okay? So now, if you take the next one, the next array, so let's take some pen. Let's take the next array, that one, let's say, okay. That one will cancel with this one. Okay. So it makes sense. If the first red one cancels with that red one, that blue will cancel with that one. And so on. So now if you look at just one just before here, so let's say this one. This one will cancel with this one. Okay. So in the end, you have fully destructive interference in this case. And the condition is, therefore, that the total length multiplied by sine theta is equal to lambda. Because again, the phase shift, the difference between these two rays must be half a wavelength. So between the full grating, it is a full wavelength. Okay, so this is our condition for the first minimum. So let's continue here. So we take that. So what angle does it show? So here we have the sine equal lambda divided by nd, and again we use the approximation that we are very far away, the screen is very far away from the slits, from the grating, and therefore the angle is very small. So in that case, the sine theta is can be approximated as just the angle itself. So this is what we get. Okay, so half width of line at theta is equal to. So this formula, in fact, is valid for the central line, okay, when theta equals zero. And if you look at another principal maximum that is located at angle theta, then the half width, the half width of this peak will be given by this. Okay. We give this without demonstration because it is out of the syllabus. It requires extensive calculations. So again, the delta theta here is the half width, okay, of that full maximum. So this shows that so here you have n at the denominator, okay, and n is large. It's a large number. Therefore, this delta theta is a very small number. Okay. Therefore, this the width of these peaks is very small. Okay. And the higher n, the narrower will this peak be, and in fact, the higher in intensity they will be. So, okay. So this is stated here. The peaks. So this stands for full width at half maximum. Okay, is much narrower in a grating than in a two-slit system. Let's now talk about diffraction. So this is a famous experiment. You have here a point light source, and here you have a circular object. And here you put a screen and you look at the shadow of that object by the light. And expectedly, you see a nice shadow, circular shadow, because the light is blocked by this circular object. However, you see a bright spot at the center. This is known as the Poisson spot, after a French scientist. So there is no way to explain this using ray geometrical optics. Okay, so this is explained by the phenomenon of diffraction. So we are going to study this. So in fact, just quickly, this dot, bright dot here, is the result of constructive interference of secondary wavelet, like Huygens principle. You know, you can say that each dot at the perimeter here, at the rim of this kind of circular object, act as a point source. And therefore, you will have constructive interference exactly at the center, there. So this is actually a picture of this experiment. So you see that Poisson spot at the center. So it's very difficult to observe because you need to have a very precise instrument. And you see also some kind of waves here. Around the shadow. So this is also due to diffraction. So what happens? Let's look at the opposite case. So instead of just a circular object, we take a slit, but with a large slit. Okay, so it has a diameter D. And we look on the screen what we observe. So there is light coming, of course, like that. And we see some interference fringes, even though we have only one slit. But the difference with the the Young interference, for example, is that this slit is large compared to the wavelength of light. It's not a small one, not a very small one. So you have a very large peak at the center and then some intermediate peaks. So let's see how we can explain this interference pattern with just one slit. So in fact, it is the same process as that we have used for gratings, because you see that here we have a large slit, but you can decompose that large slit into a series of point sources. Also, this is how it would be explained by Wigan's principle. You say that between this edge and the other edge, you have an infinite number of slits, of point sources, therefore an infinite number of slits. Okay. So for a grating, we had a large number of slits, and we were getting something like this, except that we had that all these maxima all had the same intensity. Okay, so here now we have a kind of a difference in intensity for each peak. So let's see. So what we observed for a grating, that was you were getting a minimum when this length, so when the optical path between that ray and the opposite ray was one wavelength. Okay, so it is so d sine theta equal lambda. So in that case, you have a minimum. And when you have a half a wavelength, you have a maximum. And again, here is 2 lambda, you have again a dark value. So, okay, so we can explain this pattern using this scheme. So here we can say that for minima, so for dark fringes, the condition is A sine theta equal M lambda. So A here so it is in place of D. Okay. It is the size of this slit. So here we have represented the intensity for different values of the slit. So here it is for the slit, so A, the width of the slit, equal lambda. Here 5 lambda and here 10 lambda. So when you have just one lambda, actually you get just one point source. So it makes sense that you get something like that. And then you see appearing this main maximum at the center and just one peak here. And here you have the main maximum with two peaks. And you have the width of that peak is decreasing as the width increases. Okay, so we can calculate, so you can look in your the books. So it takes quite a while to calculate, and there are several methods to calculate the intensity as a function of the angle. And we find this. So the function itself is very simple. It's a sine alpha divided by alpha squared. Alpha here is half of phi, and phi here is the phase shift between two rays at the two edges of the slit. Okay, so I can make a small drawing showing that. So if your slit is like that, you have one ray here, another ray there, and the difference here will be in fact A sine theta. So this piece, A sine theta here. And if you multiply by 2 pi over lambda, you get a phase shift. Okay. So, Okay, that's it. So with this function, you can find actually where are the minima and maxima. So the minima are found for alpha equal m pi, for m integer, which indeed correspond to that that optical path difference equal m lambda. So now let's talk again about this width. Here, so you see that the central peak full width at trough maximum, so this width, is much narrower in a wide slit like here compared to a narrow slit. And this is you can understand this if you remember what we observed for gratings. We observed exactly the same thing for gratings. And again, a grating can be considered as a wide slit with many, in fact, the contrary, a wide slit here can be considered like a grating, therefore, like having a lot of slits. Okay. So it makes sense that we find the same qualitative trend, like the peaks in a full width fatra maximum are much narrower in a grating than in a two-slit system. Okay. Again, I can make a small drawing in case you haven't caught what I want to say. So a grating is like this with many, many slits. And a wide slit is that. But you can always say, according to Huygens' principle, that a wide slit is composed of many secondary sources, point sources, like slits. So you find the same trends. All the peaks intensity is much weaker than for ideal grating. So that's the big difference. You remember, for the grating, we were getting several principal peaks, but all of the same intensity. Here, we see that we have a large intensity at the central peak and then much smaller peaks. Okay, so that's a big difference. Okay, so let's take it to a new level. We have seen what a Young double slit experiment was. We have seen gratings, just many slits, and we have seen diffraction. So now, this again is the double slit experiment. So this is intensity as a function of the angle. So all the peaks have the same intensity. And this is given by, in fact, cos squared of the phase difference here of this number. Okay, and this is coming from the optical path difference between the two rays coming from the two slits. Now, if you have just one slit, you get this intensity by diffraction. And you get this sine alpha divided by alpha squared, with alpha equal to this. Okay, so now we take two of these slits and we make a Young's double slit experiment with these two slits. So in this case, the two slits were very small, like one wavelength. So each slit was behaving like a point source. Now, they do not behave like point source. They emit this in space, both of them. So the result, using a double slit but with wide slits, is the product of the two, which is that. Okay, and the product of the intensities is given by that. Okay, so this is what we observe in reality. So we do have these peaks coming from that, but there is a modulation of these peaks due to the diffraction. Okay, like that. So here we represent another figure. So if you have so now it's about a grating. Okay, just before it was two slits. Now we have a grating. But if your slits are narrow, you get the peaks like that. This is what we have observed and shown you before. And the spacing is A, so you even have here the maxima, the principal maxima. So now if you take one single slit but with width D, so a wide slit, you get that. And again, the minima are represented here. Now you take a grating but with these slits, wide slit grating. So you will have the product of the two. So this is what you get. You get very sharp peaks, but modulated by the diffraction effect. So this is a caption of the previous figure. It's taken from crystallography and diffraction book. So I will make a brief comment about crystallography in a few slides. So this is again a slide that I have shown you before. This is for a grating, but showing also the diffraction effect. So here you have a grating with only six slits, so it's not really a grating. But still you see the effect. So you have the principal maxima located at lambda over A, 2 lambda over A, and the minima like that. And you see that the intensity is going down when you get away from the center here due to the diffraction effect. Let's see some examples of diffraction patterns. So when you have so this is a slit, okay, the black in fact is a hole, okay. So this is your object and this is what you get on the screen. And this is a diffraction pattern on the screen. So for this aperture, you would have this. So you have a large center maximum and then a big minimum and then another maximum but lower. When you increase the size of your aperture, of your slit in some sense, you actually decrease the width of your maxima. In fact, there is a reciprocal relationship between your real object and its image on the screen. Okay, you see that when the object is small, your image is large. And the contrary here, your object is now larger and your image is smaller. And now if you look at a grating, so for example this, so many slits, in fact it is even in 2D here, but okay, it's just a grating in two dimensions. So you get sharp dots on the screen. This is like the grating effect. If you just look at one line, it is just this series of very sharp peaks. Okay. So if you take this kind of grating, but at each dot you put a large slit, like this one for example, so you get this. Okay, it's a grating of large slits. And this is what you get, the image. So in fact this image, according to what we have just seen, should be the product of the interference of each dot. So something like that, multiplied by the diffraction pattern resulting from each slit, each aperture, which is like that. And indeed, it is what you get. It is a product of that multiplied by this, roughly, because the distance is different. Okay. So you can guess the each peaks, but they are modulated by this intensity. So in fact here this is in fact we refer to, this is used in crystallography because these could be atoms for example, And you can send on this X-rays so that the distance between the atom is about angstrom, 1 or 2 angstrom, and which correspond to the wavelengths of X-rays. So you can get diffraction patterns from X-rays interacting with a crystal. And what you get here is in fact a pattern reflecting the lattice. So how the atoms are organized in the crystal, multiplied by the basis. So what you attach to each site of your lattice. So in this case, you just attach a big dot like this, and you have the diffraction, this diffraction multiplied by the effect of the lattice. So you may read this, and just for your information, the relationship between this and this, you can go from one to that one mathematically. You can define this mathematically, and this one also. So you go from one to the other by a Fourier transform. Okay, so you see again the importance of the Fourier transformation. So here I just show you again. I showed you before this spectrometer when we were studying the double slit interference, but in fact, what is here is not a double slit, it is a grating. So, in that case, you can separate the light very efficiently with a grating. So, here, let's just discuss the connection with X-ray diffraction. So, with that example of NaCl, so you probably know by now that NaCl is an ionic crystal made of sodium and chlorine, so the ions. So we can so the interpretation that is can be given for the X-ray diffraction is the following. We assume that planes of atoms, for example these ones, can reflect X-rays, so electromagnetic waves, and this wave, particular wavelengths. So again, the distance here is about the wavelengths of the X-rays. So you will have interference and diffraction. So if you take ray 1, for example, this one can be reflected from this plane. Okay, so in fact, it is not the nuclei themselves which reflect the light, it is all the electrons inside the plane, because you have electrons around the nuclei, and they form, you have a density of electrons in the system here. And if you take one set of planes like this, you have some density of electrons inside these planes. And these electrons will interact with the electromagnetic wave, and you will have some reflection and transmission through these planes. So here, how it works is that, for example, you will have a partial reflection from one plane, ray 1. Ray 2 can go through one plane but reflect by the other one. Below, another ray 3 will go through the two first planes and be reflected out of the third plane, etc. So it's a bulk probe in some sense, because the X-rays can penetrate quite deeply in the material and reflect from different planes. But these will interfere, okay, outside the material. So you can look at that on the screen. And you will have, depending on the size of the distance between the planes, you will have or not destructive, constructive interference. So of course we are interested in the constructive interference. So what happens is that it is shown here. In fact, it is very similar to the thin film interference, because you have ray 1 reflected directly like this, and ray 2 penetrating into this distance in between two planes and reflected out of the second plane and getting out. So the only difference is you don't have any index of refraction in this, and the optical path difference will only be a distance. So you see that the distance traveled by ray 2 compared to ray 1 is just the green path. And this is d sine theta. So 2 d sine theta, because you have to take into account that one and this one. And theta is in this case given by that. So be careful, this is not the same as the convention in optics. In optics, we take theta is usually the angle compared to the normal. But in X-ray diffraction, they have chosen this angle as theta. Okay. Right, so in the end, you will have constructive interference if you have this 2d sine theta equal m lambda. And this is very useful because you will, if you use, you do X-ray diffraction, you know the lambda that you use. You will measure a peak at a given theta, therefore you can determine the distance between your planes. Okay, so this is used to determine the structures of crystals. And this is known as the Bragg's law. And the Bragg's, actually there was a father and son. They both got the Nobel Prize for different works. But yes, such a simple formula got a Nobel Prize. So now I would like to show you an experiment. So laser diffraction and interference, again from the MIT. Okay, let's go. So first, we start with a single slit. So we have a red laser. And we can change the width here. So at first, it starts with a narrow slit. So you have a kind of like a point source on the screen, and when you increase the width of your slit, you start seeing this interference, and your we'll see that zoom. Yeah, so the principal maxima becomes narrower. Okay, it becomes like a grating. So a pinhole is just a very small hole. So you should get the image here. Okay, so it has some kind of spherical symmetry, and you can see that it's not a perfect hole. Perfect circular hole. So now we just see the difference between wavelengths. So if you remember the wavelengths, the distance from the central maximum will depend on the wavelengths. So here we have a long wavelength, then a yellow, so a shorter wavelength, and even a shorter wavelength with the green. So we have long wavelengths at the bottom, and at the top a short wavelength. So indeed you see that the position of the maxima, so this is the first the central maximum, and this is the next one, so it is the distance is shorter. So these are some formula summary. So this is for interference, constructive, destructive, the reflection, the phase shift that you may have. You must understand and know Huygens principle, double slip experiment, since film experiment. Not much about diffraction, because you will see that in another year in more detail, etc.